gentlemen, we'll just make a start. Thank you all for coming along on Loughbrickland on behalf of the fellowship to our December meeting. Welcome to the Reverend Thomas Martin, who's going to bring us a word later, and to Victoria Salt, who's going to bring us a word in song. So welcome to both of them on behalf of the fellowship. There's just a couple of announcements. Our January meeting will be held in the hall here on the 13th of January, when we'll have Mrs. Stephanie Park along on that occasion. And then we'll have our big breakfast on the 31st of January in Banbridge Orange Hall. So if anybody wants to go along to that, I'll leave that on the table, and you can just write your name on the back of it. This has proved to be a very successful event in the past, with around 100 people normally in attendance, so I encourage you to go along to that. And then on the 8th of February, we'll have our Songs of Praise in Loughbrickland Presbyterian Church at 7 p.m. And the February meeting, we'll have John Boyd along to speak to us about missionary work in India. I have a thank you card from the Puppy Appeal organisers, RBL Dromore Branch. Thank you very much for your kind donation of £80.50 at your meeting on the 18th of November. It goes towards our total so far of just over £12,000, and is very much appreciated by all at our branch. So that was a collection at our last meeting. So thank you all for donating to that. And just on a sad note, there's been two bereavements within the fellowship. The Walsh family have suffered a bereavement since our last meeting, and the Kirkland family have suffered a bereavement since our last meeting. And the thoughts and prayers of everyone associated with the fellowship goes out to both families. Gordy, if you just open with prayer, and then Victoria, if you'd bring us the word and song, and then Thomas, you take over.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, as we come into your presence once again, we can say even at the outset that thou art altogether lovely. And Lord, we ask even that your presence would be with us tonight. Lord, as we felt even in times gone by, and Lord, how you've worked in this place, we ask once again, O God, that your Holy Spirit would come and move from seat to seat, from heart to heart. And Lord, that we can rejoice and say, those of us that are saved, that, O God, that you have kept us, and Lord, you've been with us, and you strengthen us in our daily lives. Lord, we do pray even tonight for those, O God, that would be carrying burdens or carrying, O God, conviction. Lord, we pray tonight, Lord, that you would speak and loose the chains of sin, O God, and even save souls here tonight. Lord, restore the backsliders. And Lord, give us joy, those of us that are saved tonight. And Lord, may we come out of this meeting tonight, say it was great to have been in the presence of Almighty God. Lord, bless Thomas as he brings the wee word that you have laid upon his heart. Bless Victoria, even as she would sing tonight. May she, Lord, have the voice of an angel tonight. And Lord, we will, as always, give you thanks for everything that you've done for us. Undertake for us now, we pray, and continue to bless us. And we will be careful as ever to give you all the praise, honour and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, this first piece that I'm going to sing, it's simply entitled Angels We Have Heard on High. Now, in case you think you've maybe taken a stroke and you can't understand the course is actually in Latin, and it says Gloria in Excelsis Deo, and it's basically Latin for glory to God in the highest. So just in case you don't understand, that's what it means. Glory to God in the highest.
Oh,
and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl, and remember when we walk, sometimes we fall. So fall.
Thank Victoria for those messages in song. I've no doubt that the Lord has blessed them to many of our hearts, especially my own. And we appreciate those who have gifts and talents in the way of singing. That's one thing I don't have. And in our congregation, they love to sing. And we always like someone at the front who can sing. I have to lead all the meetings myself. Thankfully, we have a good singing congregation, and they drowned out my voice. I often tell my own people on many occasions that if you want to sing out and out sing the worst singer in this house, you're going to have to sing better than I am singing, and you're going to have to sing louder than I am singing. Sometimes I take liberties, and as a visiting preacher, I would usually say the two worst singers, for I haven't met too many Free Presbyterian ministers, William McRae excluded, that can really sing. Some think they can sing, but we stick to the preaching. I certainly appreciate those messages in song that we'll hear from Victoria just a little later on. Could I just clarify, what time do we finish at, Paul?
Whenever you start.
Whenever I start. I've never said that. That's a bad thing. That's a bad thing. Folks, if you don't mind, if I stand here, if that was all right, if I got behind that little large pulpit, I wouldn't want it to be moved anywhere. I don't think it could be shifted. You just wouldn't see me. You would hear a voice, but you would see no man. So what I intend to do this evening, and it should shorten my message. That's hard to believe, but it should. I've laid aside the notes that I have, and I'm going to trust the Lord to give me, as I do a Bible reading, to give me the thoughts that He has given to me over this past while. I trust the Lord will help me to reproduce that which God has given to me. I have to tell you that I haven't come with a sermon tonight. I haven't come with some homiletic, well-prepared and thought-out homily. I do believe in my heart having prayed and asked the Lord for direction, that I come to you this evening with a word from God. I'm convinced, as Haggai the prophet did say, that I am the Lord's messenger and the Lord's message to your soul. I have a word from God to you. And therefore I ask you, please, to give attention to the word of the Lord. And I trust God will speak to your heart. If you haven't prayed this already, would you do that now? Lord, speak to me. Speak to my heart. You know, God does speak to us in these days. It's not by dreams or visions. It's not by someone professing to be a prophet or a prophetess or someone even with a word of knowledge. It's from his holy word. It's the only place God speaks to man is through the Bible. And the Bible is the complete canon of Holy Scripture. That it is the sufficient record for all men, translated thankfully into our English language. We have it here in this authorized version of Scripture, the Word of the Living God. And the Lord bless it to your heart richly this evening. Could we just bow in prayer? We're going to turn in a moment to the 46th Psalm, and then we're going to bring some thoughts. Father in heaven, we thank thee already for a sense of the divine presence. We thank thee for mercy seen and unseen this day. Lord, we don't know what could have happened to us but for the grace and mercy of our God. But we do rejoice in the knowledge that thou hast been watching over us, thou hast been with us. And we ask now, Lord, those messages in song that bring glory to the Master, lift up the Saviour and remind us once again of his birth and his coming into this world as a true man to die on the cross as our substitute, as the Saviour for sinners. We pray now as we come to contemplate for a few moments the word of the living God, that thou wouldst open our hearts, Lord, speak to each soul. There may be some here, Lord, and they are carrying a heavy burden. They've given to them a very heavy cross that they're carrying for thee. Lord, give them a word in season. We pray for some perhaps who are cold at heart, maybe at a distance from the Lord. They belong to Christ, they're saved by grace, but they're walking afar off. Lord, will you bring them back to their first love? Restore the backslider. There may be one or more, we don't know. And as yet they're not saved. They've never come to Christ. We heard about that. Cry to Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that even in this very hall now, thy Spirit would work conviction, bringing some soul or souls in repentance and faith to Christ. So to this end, I ask thee now for the infilling of the Spirit of the living God. An instrument in thy hand, I pray thou would make me to be a preacher of thy word, filled with thy Spirit, bringing honour and glory to the man of Calvary. Lord, hear and now answer prayer. We offer it believing in Jesus' precious and worthy name. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. The 46th Psalm, I tell you what I do. I start to read the Psalm and then stop and I give you some remarks that I feel the Lord has laid in my heart. The Psalm number 46, it's one of those Psalms that we don't have an author for. Most of the Psalms are attributed to David. There's some Psalms that belong to Moses, some Psalms that belong to Asaph, and there are some Psalms we don't know who the author is. We could hazard a guess. I could tell you who I think, and that's all it is. It's only my opinion. Who I think is the author. And if you disagree with me at the door, then you're welcome to disagree, because Scripture doesn't tell us who it is. But I do believe, when you look at the context, that the author of this psalm was Hezekiah. Hezekiah. Some people would say Hezekiah never wrote any psalms, never wrote any spiritual songs. Well, if you disagree with me, one thing you cannot disagree with was the occasion upon which this psalm was penned. It was that time in the reign of Hezekiah when Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, came up to besiege the city of Jerusalem And Hezekiah, if you well remember that incident, he got a letter from Rabshakeh and Sennacherib. They cried over the walls of Jerusalem in the Hebrew tongue that they were not to trust in the Lord or Jehovah, that the gods of the nations that the Assyrian army had defeated would not defend their cities. God will not defend yours. And who is the Lord? That's what they say. That we should obey him, or that you should listen to Hezekiah, who's telling you not to surrender, not to give up, but to stay behind those walls, because no one has stood before us. The remarkable incident that happened was, Hezekiah got alone with God. He talked to the Lord about this problem. In fact, the Bible tells us he spread it before the Lord. And in doing so, when he got up the next morning and looked over the battlements of Jerusalem, the army of Sennacherib, 185,000 men, lay dead outside the city walls. And as a result of that, God invited his people to come out of Jerusalem and to stand in the midst of those individuals who blasphemed the Lord, who cursed God, who told Hezekiah and the people that God would not deliver them and they must surrender. God said this. It's a remarkable verse. You probably have it in your home. You may have been given it to you in a little bookmarker, or even as a little prize at Sunday school. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. That's the scene that sets that little verse apart from any other verses. God called the inhabitants of Jerusalem to a battlefield and to a place where one angel left heaven and one single angel destroyed 185,000 of God's enemies. And it was in that context that I believe Hezekiah was instructed of God to speak to the Lord's people. As they stood among the carnage, God spoke to them and said, "Be still. Have a look around you. And know that I am God alone. None can deliver out of my hand. And I cannot be defeated. I will be exalted among the heathen." Have a look. It's a future reference. It's prophetic. It only has a past application. Certainly a present one for us spiritually. But it's prophetic. It points to the end time, when the Lord will come again. And the Lord will stand in the midst of his defeated enemies. And he will say to his blood-bought, redeemed people, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth." See, as Spurgeon said of this psalm, happen what may, the people of God are happy and secure in the doctrine of this psalm. It was Matthew Henry, if you read his commentary on this psalm, who said, "We may, in the singing of this psalm, apply it to our spiritual enemies, or we may apply it to the public enemies of the kingdom of Christ in this earth." And I do believe we have the right to do that. It's a treasure house, just waiting to be opened. And that's what I want simply to do just now, is to read this portion. And I trust God will open to you the good treasure of his word and give you some choice jewels and nuggets, precious stones, gold and silver, that which is lasting from his precious word. The 46th Psalm, rightly called Luther's Psalm, that Protestant reformer of the 16th century, whenever he was in trouble, and whenever the Pope threatened him, I think we're on safe ground talking about the Pope in this place. I don't think I'd be thrown out for that. It'd be a strange day if you were. But whenever he was battling with the papacy, whenever he was doing battle with the Pope, and whenever the Pope issued all his bulls against Martin Luther, whenever he was threatened, even of his life, he would have said to his friends, "Come, let us sing the 46th Psalm." Any wonder, whenever you hear these words, Psalm 46, verse 1, let us now hear the word of the Lord. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. Selah. But to stop there, because that's exactly what God has told us to do. That word Selah, I hear people reading this psalm at funeral services, and that word Selah is never used. They ignore it altogether. I've been at hospital beds. This psalm has been read by clergymen, and they have omitted the word Selah. But I say something to you. It's the same as omitting the first word of the psalm, God. Because the word Selah is as much inspired as the word God is. And the reason why I say that to you is because this word Selah, under inspiration, teaches us something if we were singing the psalm. It means to pause. That's what it means. When you're singing the psalm, it means to pause and to take a deep breath and then to move on with greater strength to sing the next portion that ends at verse 7 with another Selah. But when you're reading the psalm, the word means pause. Think about what you have just read. It means meditate upon what you have read. And therefore God forbids us to move on to the next portion in this psalm until we have obeyed him. And the command in reading to stop right there, to go back again and to meditate and think about what you have just read. The wonderful thing about it is John Phillips, he has a great commentary on the book of Psalms, and while you may not agree with him in all things, I would recommend his commentaries on the book of Psalms. And he says of this word Selah, and perhaps he doesn't know that he was really speaking in a language that I can understand, because here's what he said, and he's not from Northern Ireland, and he's not an Ulster man, but here's what he says. The word Selah means, and I put it in a polite way, what do you think of that? But in Northern Ireland we would go, what do you think of that? That's exactly how John Phillips interprets the literal Hebrew word Selah. And when you finish there, you're reading this. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear. Now what do you think of that? That's exactly how you're to read that psalm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will we not fear. And he goes on to speak about the mountains being carried into the midst of the sea, the earth being removed, the waters roaring with and troubled with the roar thereof. And what the psalmist is, I believe, implying here is the worst of times. Spiritually speaking, if you think of the earth removing, the mountains shaking, the waters being troubled, you know what it is? It is your world falling apart. That's what it is. I spent 3 hours with a dear soul today. And I'll tell you something. In her bereavement, her world has fallen apart. I took her to the Psalms. I read the verses to her. And I says, you know, it points to the end of the age, when the Lord returns, when this earth itself and the heavens will be purged by fire, and the mountains will shake at his appearing, and the very people of nations that are gathered will tremble in their soul. It will be the worst of times for the unconverted, for the sinner, but for the child of God. God will be your refuge on that day. God will be your strength on that day. God will be the one who upholds you, a very present help in that day. Therefore, you're not to be afraid. But if you're unconverted in this hall this evening, that is, if you are not saved, I'm not even saying about church going. That's commendable. Good works or any other rites or rituals of the church that you've had administered to you. I'm simply saying, if you're not converted, if you're not saved, on that day, you have no refuge. On that day, you'll have no strength to stand before God. And you'll have no help in the day of trouble. Terrible times are coming upon this earth when the Lord returns, and he's coming soon. We need to be ready. But for the child of God, when this world will fall apart, it's good to know you've got a refuge. You're hiding in Christ. You're safe in the Lord. You're underneath the precious blood. You're secure in the work of his cross. His righteousness will never be tainted. His peace never be disturbed. And all that he has done for you cannot be shaken. You're safe in Christ. But you know, there's a spiritual application. They're individuals and they're not even looking forward to Christmas. I'm not going to be a prophet of doom here. I'm simply being truthful. Because there's a family member this year, perhaps. They've passed on. There's maybe a child out in the world. And you would love to see them back in the home again. And perhaps you're not looking forward to Christmas because the family may not be there. Or some circumstance, and you feel when you look at things now and what they once were, your world seems to have fallen apart. But I have a word from God for you. God is your refuge. That is, he hides me in the time of trouble. God is your strength. That is, he holds me up in the time of trouble. And God is your help. He helps me in the time of trouble. And I can say this to you now. And some people for some reason think that ministers or pastors, they live away up there on cloud nine. I was going to say cuckoo land, but that probably would be true. I'm thinking more heavenly and more serene. Cloud nine. As if they have never had trouble. They have no pain, no anguish. They have no burdens. Everything is roses for them. But I'm telling you now, I'm a sinner just like yourself. I'm saved by God's grace. But I'm not free from trouble, pain, disappointment, heartache, sorrow, family trouble. Not at all. But I can tell you something right now. Even when I think my world has collapsed, I'm standing here tonight because God is my refuge. God is my strength. God is a very present help in all of my trouble. Therefore, I will not fear. Though my world seems to fall apart, my God will never change. My circumstances will, but the Lord won't. Jesus Christ the same, yesterday and today and forever. Let's read verse 4. There is a river, the stream whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Meditate. Pause. Think about what you've read. Read it again. And say, and what do you think of that? There is a river. That's a tremendous statement. We often hear some of our young people coming to sing, and they sing about the river. And some speak about the river that you cross over. Some speak about the river that you gather around. Others speak about the river that is within you, the Spirit of God, etc. But here, and this is why I believe Hezekiah was the author of the psalm. I don't know him. I'd probably just ask for a show of hands here. Has anybody been to Israel? The land of Israel. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Very good. There you are. What was it like? I've never been. I used to say when I was young, we never got any holidays. Bangor on the 13th. We broke every rule in the book, by the way. The Lurgan ones go to Bangor, but everybody else is at Scarborough. And I think under the old rules, they may still get fined 1 shilling for breaking rank with their brethren. These Lurgan men are totally rebels, that's all I can say. I'm one myself, by the way. I'm not a rebel, a Lurgan man. But what I will say is this. I've never been to Israel, but I know folks who have been. And I'm not sure of those who have been. Have you ever gone through what is known as Hezekiah's conduit? No? Well, you would need to be a little thinner than I am to get through it. What it is a conduit, a tunnel. And it's very narrow. And it has about 2 feet of water in it. I would just be right up to my head and step through that safely. But it is 1,777 feet long. And Hezekiah, in his day and generation, he got the people of Jerusalem knowing that Sennacherib was on his way. His armies would soon besiege the city of Jerusalem. And here's what he did. He diverted the spring of Gihon in the Kidron Valley, an ancient supply of water for the city of Jerusalem. And he diverted that spring of Gihon coming from deep in the Kidron Valley, and he brought it through solid rock, 1,777 feet, hewn out of solid rock. You can walk through Hezekiah's conduit today in the land of Israel. It's still there. And he diverted the spring, and he brought a reservoir of water into the city of God, Jerusalem, the holy city. And then outside he covered it over so that the enemy wouldn't see that the spring away down in the Kidron Valley was diverted, and it was supplying the city of Jerusalem. And whenever Hezekiah stood that day and he listened to the Assyrian army blaspheme the Lord, and I have no doubt, although we have no record in scripture, they would have said, your water supply in the city will soon run dry. And the white flag of surrender will be waved over the walls, or there may not be 13 brave men behind those walls to keep the gates locked, but they will surrender, and you will eventually submit to me. And Hezekiah could say to his people, there is a river. There is a secret source of water, a supply for the people of God within the city of Jerusalem. And the enemy knew nothing, absolutely nothing, of that source. It was secret. It was only known to the people of God. And it was only used and beneficial to the people of God. And when they besieged the city, the first thing that happens is you run out of water. Whenever I was in Her Majesty's hotel a number of years ago, the Mays prison, for those who don't know where it is, I can tell you that men were on hunger strike. I was on hunger strike. I always went on hunger strike to dinner time, and that's as far as I got. But men went on hunger strike, and some were 52 or 58 days on hunger strike. But one thing they couldn't do without for more than 3 or 4 days was water. They had to be given fluids. Whether they took it themselves or if they refused it, it was given to them in another form. It's the only way you could keep those men alive for so long without food. And without water, we couldn't live. I'll tell you this, Hezekiah knew that, and he brought the water into Jerusalem. And the spiritual lesson is very simple. It says there is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God. And let me tell you something, for the child of God, in all your times of trouble, in all your times of trial and difficulty, I have to say this to you, as Hezekiah told his people literally, there is a river spiritually. The streams whereof will make your heart glad. And that river is God himself. God himself in Jeremiah 2 verse 13 says, my people have hewn themselves out cisterns, bitter waters, and they have forsaken me, the fountain of life. God himself, the Father, is the river. And the streams of that river are His grace, His mercy, His kindness, His goodness. You sit here tonight, if you're saved, because of the streams from the river of God Himself, of His grace and mercy and love to you. It has sustained you, and it will go on keeping you until the Lord returns and beyond that. And the river is Christ. Did He not say to the woman at the well, "Whoso drinketh of the water that I shall give them shall never thirst again"? And sinner, if you're here tonight without Christ, He's the water of life. Just as water is essential to preserve and keep people living, so the living water, Christ, can give you eternal life and eternal satisfaction. But you need to come to Him and trust Him as your Saviour. And could I say, the river is the Holy Spirit of God. John chapter 7, where the Lord Jesus said of the Spirit of God, "He shall be in you as a river of living water, and He shall be literally flowing through you." And that raging torrent, it speaks of the power of the Holy Spirit. The river is the Word of God. Psalm 1, about the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord. He is a tree planted by the rivers of water. His leaf will never fade, and he will grow and mature. And I say to you, there is a river, but there's more than a river for the people of God. There is not only a marvelous river, but there's a mysterious resident. I want you to look at verse 5. Remember, Selah, pause for thought. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. You ever heard someone saying to you, or have you said it to yourself, or has the devil whispered this to you? Where is God when you need Him? Where is He? You're in trouble. You're in trials. There's problems in your life. Things are going wrong, whether financially, whether physically with your health, or whether some other problem in your life, some great difficulty, and the devil says, "Where is your God?" That's exactly what Sennacherib said to Hezekiah. "Where's your God now? He hasn't stopped me getting to the walls of Jerusalem, and He's not stopped me getting in there." And listen, here's what Hezekiah said to the people. God is in the midst. That's where He is. He hasn't forsaken you. And if you cannot trace Him in your trial, and I can say this by experience, I've been there, you need to trust Him. And you can trust Him. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. Do you know what the word means? It means to slip. It means to apostatize. That is to abandon Christ. And God is with the child of God, and there's no trouble will ever cause you to perish, slip into hell, to be moved. I'll quote the verse and I'll move on quickly. Christ says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And all whom Christ died for and saved by His precious blood will never be lost. They're sure of heaven. Their sins are forgiven. It is well. It is well with my soul. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered His voice, the Lord of hosts is with us. I want you to notice in the English those words, "with us." Can anybody tell me what the Hebrew of those words is? Well, you should know it. You say, "I've never heard of Hebrew in my life." You have. Can you tell me what the Hebrew of those words is? What's the Hebrew word? Emmanuel. I tell you, what is it?
Emmanuel.
Emmanuel. We didn't get the L in because it's added later, Emmanuel. That's exactly what that is. The Lord of hosts is with us. That word "with us" is one word. It's Emmanuel. And whenever you put the word "El," which means the mighty God, you have Emmanuel. It's the time of the year when we think of Emmanuel, God with us. Where is the Lord when you're in trouble? He's with you. And listen, I haven't time to expound this. That word, or those words, is a compound name for the Lord. And one of the delights of my own soul is to study the names of the Lord. It's the name Jehovah Sabaoth. Not Jehovah Sabbath. Jehovah Sabaoth. It literally means Lord of hosts, the captain of the army. And listen, If you're a student of the Bible, I challenge you to do this right now. Well, not right now, later on. Do this. Check your Bible. Every reference, when that word is used, Lord of hosts, every incident, not one exception to this room, God only reveals himself under that name, the captain of the armies of heaven, when his people are at their weakest. When you're in trouble, that's when the Lord comes under that name. And the reason he does that, he reveals himself by his name. It means he's intending to do something. He's going to fight for you. You ever heard it when you're a young fella, when you hit somebody? Hopefully you didn't. Maybe you were the one hit. I'd get my dad for you. No one ever said that about me, because that's too small. I never says I'd get my dad for you. You used to laugh. But I tell you, we have the Lord on our side. If you're saved, the Lord's with you, and he's on your side, and he'll not forsake you. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Now, I want you to notice something. I don't know what Bible you have, and I'm not here to point any Bible out or say anything, but I'm just going to say to you, now, not all translations do this, some do, but I know the Authorized does. It makes a distinction in the English, a wonderful way that you can distinguish the names of God. Even though we're reading the Hebrew in our mother tongue, English, I can still tell you what name the writer is using. Because the translators of the Authorized version of Scripture have kept true to the original autographs. They've preserved and enshrined in English language the wonderful names of our God. Because God reveals himself through his name, we can't change that. Whenever you see in your English Bible the word Lord in verse 7, it's all in capital letters, L-O-R-D. Every time you see L-O-R-D in your English Bible, it's always the name Jehovah. Always. Do you see the word God there in verse 7? G-O-D. Whenever that's capital G and small case O-D, it's always the name Elohim, the Creator God. So these are different names the Lord uses. He is Elohim, the creator of all things. He is Jehovah, the I Am, the omnipresent God, who's in covenant relationship with his people. And it is the divine name of God. And elsewhere, I haven't time to do this, elsewhere, I take you to 2 Samuel, classic use of this language, where you get capital L, small case O-R-D, and it's the name. It's the name Adonai, or Lord or Master. And here, Hezekiah uses the name Jehovah and the name Elohim right throughout the psalm. Let's read on and we'll finish. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow, cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. He still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Now what do you think of that? Time has beaten me. I'd love to tell you something else about those final verses. But I finish with this. The Lord says, come. Behold the works of the Lord. And there are many works. But I'd finish here. The greatest work is not the creation of this earth. And what a work that is. The greatest work of God is Calvary. The work of Christ at the cross. And the Lord invites you, come, behold that work. Consider what Christ has done for sinners like you and me. Consider he suffered, bled and died. He came into this world. We remember at this season, I don't know what your point of view on Christmas is, whether you accept it or reject it, or whether you call it a pagan festival, or you say Christ was born in April instead of December. One thing I know is Christ came into the world and died for sinners like you and me. And God says, come, behold the work of my Son at Calvary. Come and behold what desolation he has made of sin. And the power of the devil that enslaves men and women and damns their soul in hell for all eternity. Come to Christ. Trust him tonight. Make Christ your refuge, your strength, and a very present help in time of trouble. Selah. Now, what do you think of that? We'll ask our sister Victoria if she'll bring her final messages in song. Thank you.
It's entitled "I'd Rather Have Jesus," and if you're listening to your brother Mr. Martin tonight, all the Christians who all have been born again and here tonight, this is our hope and prayer that even this Christmas season, that no matter what gifts you get or whatever you may put before the Lord Jesus Christ, that you would choose him mm-hmm. over anything, whether you would put him before money, before fame, before anything. We just trust that you would trust that you would accept the Lord Jesus into your heart mm-hmm. even tonight. And I'm sure Mr. Martin would be available to talk to you, but I would strongly ask you to consider just accepting and trusting him and asking him into your life.
Victoria, for those words and song. Would you rather have Jesus? That's the question you have to ask yourself tonight. And the message that our brother brought us, God is our refuge. If you're in any time of trouble or despair, come to the Lord. That's your only way out of things. And just ask you to consider all the messages you've heard here tonight. All the messages, but just one simple message, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank our brother, and thank Victoria for the messages that have brought. There's just a couple of other announcements I forgot to mention. There's a craft fair in the hall here on Saturday. The hall committee's run a craft fair. It's from 10 o'clock to 3. If anybody wants to come along to that, the entrance is £3. And also, if anybody's interested in fifing on Lambay Drummond, there's classes starting here tomorrow night, the last to announce. So, just before I ask maybe William to close, do as usual, close in prayer. Whenever Victoria was singing Away in a Manger, I think I seen all the lips moving. So maybe if you play it again and we'll all join in. Mm-hmm. Do that, and then William, if you close in prayer.
Thank you. Lord God Almighty, we just thank you once more that we are able to come freely into thy presence, Lord. We do thank you, Lord, that it teaches us in thy precious word that where the twos and threes are gathered, that there am I in the midst of them. And Lord, we do thank you and we do praise your most wonderful name, Lord. We do thank you for Victoria. We thank you for Thomas, Lord, for bringing the word tonight, Lord. We pray, Lord, that the word would find a place in our hearts. Lord, that it would lay upon our hearts. Lord, that we would consider thy word. Lord, that we truly, you would open up the word, Lord, upon our hearts, Lord. Even our own private study, Lord, that we would really understand thy word. And we thank you for the blessing of being able to have thy word. We thank you, Lord, that we can read it in our own native tongue, Lord. We thank you for the freedoms that we do have in this country to read thy word, to meet freely, to worship you, to praise thy name, Lord. And Lord, your name is worthy of all praise, all worship and glory. And Lord, I just pray for those who do not have the freedoms which we take for granted, Lord. Lord, there are so many who cannot meet freely. There's those, Lord, who do not own thy word, who cannot read thy word. Lord, and I just pray for them. I just pray, Lord, that you would just move in those situations. Lord, for with man things are impossible, but with you all things are possible. And I just pray, Lord, that in the midst of the darkness, in the midst of where there is not hope, Lord, that you would bring the hope, that you are the hope for all generations, Lord. And Lord, you are the same God of yesterday that as today and tomorrow, Lord. Lord, that you are always with us, that you are omnipresent, Lord. Lord, that you will never leave us nor forsake us. But Lord, time and time again we walk away from you. I just pray, Lord, that you would just lead us back onto thy pathway, Lord. Lord, that you would forgive us for the times whenever we err, whenever we do not trust in you fully, Lord. Help us, Lord, to fully trust in you, to fully commit our lives unto you. Lord, that at this time, Lord, we just pray, at this time of Christmas, Lord, that we would fully consider that you came onto this world, Lord, to die upon the cross of Calvary. Lord, you came into this world to die. You left the splendor of heaven, the glories of heaven, Lord, that you could go to the cross of Golgotha. Lord, for my sins that held you there, all of our sins, Lord, held you and hold you upon that cross of Calvary, Lord. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, we praise your name, that you went the whole way. Lord, that the work of Calvary, it is finished, Lord. Lord, that you rose triumphant, Lord, over death, Lord. Lord, that we might be set free, Lord. Set free from the sinfulness of our lives, Lord. If we had only cling on to thee, Lord. If we had only reach out to the Master, Lord. And just pray, Lord God, that we would just help us to reach to you, to trust you, to commit every aspect of our lives, Lord. But Lord, I just pray, Lord, I just plead for those family members, those friends, Lord, who are far from the kingdom of glory. Lord, time and time again we have cried unto you for them. But Lord, just help us to be like the persistent widow, to cry, to plead, Lord, just for those who are far from thy kingdom, Lord. Lord, draw them unto thyself, Lord, that they would know you, Lord. Just pray, Lord, for those who, Lord, have nothing at this time of Christmas. Lord, that they would realize that the greatest gift ever given was the gift of salvation upon the cross, Lord. Lord, that gift was freely given. Lord, we thank you that you cannot earn salvation. Lord, that you cannot do nothing, Lord. But Lord, we must come humbly, weak as we are, sinners, Lord, and just trust you that by grace and through faith alone, Lord, that we can get into heaven, Lord. And Lord, I just praise your most wonderful name, that name that is worthy of all praise, glory, and honor, Lord. And just pray, Lord, and just thank you, Lord, for this time of fellowship and meeting, Lord. And just pray, Lord, even that you would just bless the food to our bodies, that you would strengthen us for thy service. Lord, that in every act of ours, Lord, that we would bring all honour and glory and praise unto thy most precious and wonderful name, Lord. And just pray, Lord, that you would just even take us to our homes in safety. In all things, Lord, we just pray and praise your most wonderful and glorious and everlasting name. Lord Jesus, I praise the most wonderful name. Amen. Amen.